Hey guys, welcome to round two. We are going to keep this again on the draw. We have a turn two Rattleclaw Mystic into turn three Hedron Archive hand. And if our opponent does kill the Rattleclaw Mystic, not a big deal. We'll just play some Elvish Visionaries. Opponent spends his turn tutoring up a basic land forest. Oh hey, we have something sweet to do on turn three. That makes me feel pretty good about fetching the red-green dual land with this Wooded Foothills, because we'll have plenty of basics to put into play later with the Nissa's Pilgrimage, if that's a thing that we want to do. There are some hands where you really want to fetch basics with Wooded Foothills, but I think with this hand it is fine not to. From our opponent's early plays here, it looks like we could be facing Rally. That is the deck that I would put him on. He could also be on something rogue, you know, like you could put Elvish Visionary into basically any old deck as we see in our hand here. But yeah, this looks like a Rally mana base. Sometimes they play like an Evolving Wilds or two. My opponent fetched before playing the Elvish Visionary because he had enough land drops in hand, so that tells us a little bit about his hand. So the way that Ramp wins this matchup is they manage to exile Rally's white sources. So that's gonna be our sub-goal this game. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. One natural land drop away from Dragonlord Atarka-ing. Which is solid in this matchup. It would just like remove what pressure he has in play. Wouldn't do anything if his plan is to like Collected Company on my end of turn, I guess. Okay, but I could just like sweep his board. I think I would do that over like play some ramp spells. But I think we have to play some ramp spells anyway. I'm just thinking real quick. Yeah, I'm just going to fire off, and this is Pilgrimage. This is Pilgrimage, pretty solid card. Giving you my land drop. And then I think I'm just going to fire off the other one, because that will give me my land drop for next turn too. And then I can play the Oath of Nissa, hopefully finding something awesome to do. Something that's better than a Dragonlord Atarka. I'd like to like actually sweep my opponent's board. Or start targeting his mana base anyway. Huh. I guess I take a Visionary. Bottom those guys. You notice that we played our ramp spells before we played the Oath of Nissa. Just to like strip lands out of the deck, so the Oath of Nissa would have my opponent just messaged me, I can beat the Visionary! He's excited that was the card that I hit off of Oath of Nissa. I've talked to a lot of people about the matchup, and the Rally deck is favored if they can get a fast Nantuku Husk draw, because Nantuku Husk is a way for them to like beat an Ugin. Okay, cool. So what are we doing here? 1, 2, and it's just a lot of pressure. Like Nantuku Husk would turn Visionaries that he played off the top into just like a pile of damage. Well, that's not what he has here. So we've had time to set up. He's hit us down to 12. That's like a good sign for him, but I don't think it's going to quite be fast enough. Unless he's main decking Disdainful Strokes, maybe. Anyway, I should do a count of my mana. So 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Oh, this can only be for Cultless, right? So 10 mana. I guess I lead with Visionary. Okay, I'm going to fire off the Atarka. Seems solid. So he's going to sacrifice the Jace in response, of course. Because why wouldn't you? And I thought I'd have one more mana, so I must have miscounted somewhere. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah, I should have 2 mana, right? No, this is 7. This is 7, not 6. That's right. Okay. I'll keep that one. Yeah, I like that multiple Oath of Nissa's can, like, fuel delve and stuff. I'm not going to get the shuffle effect. I'm just going to get the land here. Put these on the bottom. Yeah, so that's 2 Oath of Nissa's deep. So we've gotten 6, 7 cards, and then a draw step, 8 cards towards finding some, like, some huge colorless creature. And then on my next turn, I'm going to be able to draw... I'm going to be going 3 more cards deep. So... I think I will lead with that. Opponent passed with a bunch of stuff up. I think that implies collected company. I don't know how afraid I should be of that. I think I'm going to serve and see if he like collected companies into like a reflector mage or whatever to bounce my dragon. Because then a post-combat Chandra could be good. It could be fine. Maybe my elf shouldn't have served. Doesn't look like he was in the collected company boat. So he must be sitting on rally. He's got at least one rally in hand. He's going to, like, end of turn rally, draw a card with the visionary now. I guess he would be able to... Yeah, that attack might have just been really, really, really bad, getting him a card deeper towards juice. Because if his plan is just to rally and flip his Jace, then we definitely shouldn't be giving him extra cards off of said rally. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5... I just thought that, like, if I attack with the Elvish Visionary and he's sitting on collected company, then he's kind of incentivized... to fire off the company just so he takes one less point of damage, because then he like finds a 2-3 or whatever to block my visionary. That's what was going through my head, but I didn't think about if he was sitting on rally, how that would just be a really bad play. Anyway. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Potentially one more if we find something off the visionary. Alright, I'm going to fire off visionary. And then I think I'm going to Chandra and 0 Chandra here. I think that's the plan. Assuming I don't draw something awesome. Okay, I didn't. I did not. Cool. Yeah, so he's fetching out one nice thing about this is that he's fetching out his second white source. Oh, he didn't rally there. That's interesting. Yeah, he apparently just had like a really lackluster draw. He really needed his Jace to stick around, I guess. Do we have lethal in play? 1, 2, 3, 4, plus 6. So if we go Ulamog, exile your 2 guys. And he doesn't have collected company. He would have had to just draw the collected company, though. Does Reflector Mage bounce dragon earlier than now? It's really weird to go Ulamog and like not target his white sources. I think that's how you generally win the matchup. So it's pretty risky, which is why I'm thinking here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. So we'd have 4 mana left over post Ulamog. Yeah, that's tough. I'm just gonna hit his white sources. he's representing company. Even like a rally for two would stop me from having lethal. So I think it's just way too greedy to go for that line here. When instead we can just win the game the usual way. Okay, and he just packs it into the Ulamog. Yeah, Ulamog's real strong in the matchup. It's like I said, your general plan is to exile the opponent's white sources. So Ugins are coming in. They're not very good if the opponent has a sac outlet in play, but if they don't have a sac outlet, then they're very strong. So I might actually want Roasts just to slow the opponent down, target Nintuku Husk. I think that's fine. I think Chandra is still fine. I think Dragonlord Atarka is okay. It's a little bit less necessary now that we've upped our Ugin count. And Ulamog is just way better than Kozilek in this matchup, so I'm not going to bring in Kozilek. Like, a rally for three has a casting cost of, like, five on the stack, so Kozilek's not countering much. I can, like, counter a collected company by discarding one of these, I guess. And it's way better to exile some of my opponent's lands than it is to draw a few cards in this matchup. So Worldbreaker, surprisingly super, super duper relevant. So right now I'm deciding whether how many Roasts I want to bring in, how many Elvish Visionaries I want to shave. I think something like this could be good. We could also like shave a Chandra. That could also be strong. I kind of like that. I think Dragonlord Atarka is like slightly better than Chandra, but obviously it costs one more, so having a split makes sense in that regard. Yeah, I kind of like this. I kind of like this a lot. Let's rock it. Elvish Visionary isn't bad in the matchup. It's just that the cards that we're bringing in seem a little bit more important. That's one nice thing about it, is that it makes it real easy to sideboard. In matchups where your mana dorks are being targeted, you can cut your Rattleclaw Mystics and then still have something to do on turn two with the Elvish Visionary, which is awesome. And then, well, this is not a very exciting hand, but I think we're going to keep it. And then in matchups where you need slots to board cards in, because Elvish Visionary is, like, by definition a filler card, you can cut it without feeling much remorse. That was my phone alarm going off at 8:30 in the morning. Hey, 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 Elvish Visionary, find me the goods. Yeah, I set it for 8:30 because I want to get back on, like, a normal schedule. So naturally, the past, like, 3 days in a row, I've woke up at, like, 4 in the morning or whatever. Just has not been effective at all. So Stratus Dancer is pretty great. Solid way for him to start applying the beats. Gets around the Elvish Visionary and the Roast. And Dugo Husk. I'm just going to get that off the board as soon as possible. Not this turn, because I can just block it. And it doesn't really fit my curve very well. So I'm just going to nick Nissa's Pilgrimage. Cool. And then next turn, I can Roast the Husk plus play another Pilgrimage. I think that's a little bit better curve than if I just spend my turn roasting and hitting him for one. I'm just going to block. Should I maybe have just taken the damage, see if the roast resolved. There's a real danger of getting it, like, Reflector Maged or whatever on a later turn, though. He's like, oh, I have responses. Yeah, we might be losing this game, boys. So if I'd spent my turn three just roasting, he wouldn't have the Husk in play. We'd be in way less danger of just dying to a fast rally. Because now he's in a place where he can just, like, sack the Catacomb, sack the Stratus Dancer, rally for three, get a lot of damage in there. Oh, I should have played Shrine. What am I thinking? I'm not thinking, that's what. This is Pilgrimage. Gonna strip a lot of the basics out of the deck. No more basic forests. Good thing to keep in mind. I was gonna say, if I draw my 10 drop and don't have, like, both Shrine of the Forsaken Gods in play, which I should at this point, then I'll feel pretty silly. That one, I guess. Well, the white source and his only green source. Seems like a pretty good one to hit. We are pretty close to just dying, though. That's the real danger here. This game makes me want to, like, I don't know, maybe shave one of my 10 drops for another Chandra. The old double collected company. Is this lethal? Because I would block probably a Nantuku Husk, and he sacrifices it. So it's 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah, he just has lethal in play. And that's how you lose. So we've seen both how you lose and how you win in this matchup so far. I don't think Kozlik's return is very good. It would have been really good that game. Would have been super good that game. Because the Worldbreaker would have flashed it back. I'm going to experiment. I haven't actually played this matchup much from this side. So I'm going to try some Kozlik's returns. Yeah, I don't think Dragonlord Atark is that good. Not nearly as good as Ugin anyway. Okay. Two returns, two roasts. Could be fine. And Ulamog is great and all, but it's also at the top end of the curve. Let's try this out. Let's try this. I just realized Pulse of Murasa could actually mess with a rally. Rolling on the play. I guess our opponent also joined us in Paris. We're down to 5. Land drop number 4. Do we want to keep this? I don't think we do. I think we want, like, an actual ramp spell. So I'm going to bottom that. It increases our chance of just, like, drawing a bunch of dragons and Ugins and stuff. So we, like, reverse flood. But we already have 3 land drops towards this Hedron Archive. And an actual ramp spell would be really, really nice. One nice thing about that fetch is that it's a... it would have been a second red source for Chandra. But I think we have enough red sources in the deck where we don't have to worry about that too much. But maybe I'm just wrong. Get a second basic out there so a fetch land can get me. It comes into play untapped red source if I need to. Okay, cool. Drone Archive. Turn 4 on the play. Real slow. Real slow and easy, like. Yeah, I'm just going to Chandra down tick for 3. We could also Dragonlord Atarka, but Dragonlord Atarka doesn't actually clear this board, so. Grab a duel. Yeah, Chandra is actually a little bit more awkward against the banned Collected Company deck, because when they're holding up mana, you don't know if it's for Collected Company, because then they could fire it off at your end of turn and just kill the Chandra. Or like a Dromoka's Command, like if they have a bunch of X3s and you down take Chandra for 3, and they're like, put a 1-1 counter on this, you're just like, okay. And they apply so much pressure that it's real awkward. But right now, We're in a pretty good situation. To the point where I'm not sure if Chandra should be upticking or zeroing. It's close. It's close for sure. He's gonna get a scry. So we uptick, we get to smack him for a 6. He drops down to 16. But yeah, that doesn't actually help our clock at all. I guess I should have played the Sanctum of Ugin this turn. What did I play? I played another Shrine. Yeah, that's fine. It's fine. I'm just gonna 0. Cool. Yeah, so upticking here didn't actually increase our clock because the Dragon Lord Atarka hits for that amount. But it doesn't really matter the turn that we uptick the Chandra. Like, we could even wait one more turn. I'm doing it now because I want him to fire off a Collected Company if he's sitting on one. Drops down to 8. These vegetables, man, exploding all over the place. Yeah, so instead of one of the Shrines of the Forsaken Gods, we should have had a Sanctum of Ugin in play, I guess, and then we could be tutoring up a cultless humongous threat when we played the Ugin. I don't think it's gonna matter. Our opponent's down to 5 cards here. Yeah, he holds out on the Collected Company, which is smart. Gets 5 power in play. He's gonna need to deal with my Dragon Lord somehow. And even just like Chandra uptick plus Ugin uptick is a lot of damage. So the opponent is definitely in rough shape. Okay. I considered cracking Kedron Archive on his end of turn, but like just finding an extra 2 mana with Explosive Vegetation is better because like I can use the extra 2 mana to crack the Hedron Archive. There's 2 fewer lands in the deck. Yeah, I think I'm just gonna downtick Ugin. But I'm gonna sacrifice my Hedron Archive first. Just in case I find something particularly spicy. Like another Chandra. Yeah, I'm just gonna downtick this. Nuke his board. Seems good. So we can't replay the dragon, but we can fire off another exploding vegetables. Now the Ugin itself has him on a 2-turn clock. I kind of just want to use Ugin to exile his 2 cutthroats, but that I would be trading the Ugin to do that. But I'm trying to think of the ways that my opponent can possibly get back into this game, and I think one of them is I go Dragon Lord Atarka, kill your 2 guys. Okay, he would gain what, 4 life, because they're both in play when they both die. So we'd gain 4 life, he'd go up to 9. We'd dome him down to 6. We have an Ugin on 4 and a dragon in play. Feeling pretty good about ourselves. But then he's got Rally for 3 potential. And then the Catacomb Sifters can, like, the Colossus Eldrazi can sacrifice to activate the Ailee with double cutthroat in play. And, like, it kind of gives him a line back into the game. Whereas if I just trade the Ugin, then yeah, I mean, Dragon Lord Atarka is way easier for him to deal with than Ugin. But I think we just have a way better chance of winning if we do this. Weirdly, it's it seems strange. I know it seems strange. We got all of our basic forests out, right? This is 6, 7. I thought there were 10. I might be thinking of a different version of the deck. I guess I'll fire it off. Nope, one more. Another Reflector Mage. Not a big deal. Oh, nice. Yeah, that that closes things up very neatly. Yeah, I imagined when I boarded out a copy of Ulamog that I'd be more like playing Worldbreaker to tutor up Ulamog, but this is good. It's going to hit his two white sources. Some Sacrifice Sanctum. Can we get Worldbreaker? And I think we can cast Worldbreaker, right? Yep. Opponent runs us the GGs. Cool. Yeah, so that, I mean, he did mold a 5, but he was on the draw and we mold a 6 on the play. So we both had very slow starts here, but the important thing about the matchup happened, where you, like, strip their white sources and then take them off of Rally. And I think that was really key. The one misplay that I think we did in the match, the most egregious one, the one that I noticed anyway, was not running out the Sanctum of Ugin. And instead I played the Shrine that one turn. The game would have been a lot less close if I'd played my lanes correctly. And part of that was that I just didn't think through my full turn at the time. Like, there was a chance that I was going to Chandra uptick. And maybe I was thinking that, like, well, obviously I uptick Chandra here. And so then I just, like, made my land drop without thinking about it too much. But when I decided to zero, it became clear that I should have played the other land. So then when I played the Ugin later, I could have tutored up an Ulamog then. We wouldn't have had to rely on the top of our library. Our top of the library is pretty good at that point, though. We've stripped out all the lands and such, which is one of the nice things about this deck. I really like that Hedron Archive can just be cashed in for a couple of cards. It's a really satisfying card to play with. All right, on to round 3. See you guys there. Yeah.